Hello and welcome to the fourth module of this health diplomacy series by the IBE. My name is Sebastian Winter. I'm IBE's head of policy and research, and it's my distinct pleasure and honor today to walk you through this e-learning module. Now, you will have heard the first three modules of this health diplomacy series, and today we will talk about leveraging the World Health Organization's Intersectoral Global Action Plan on Epilepsy and Other Neurological Disorders, IGAP for short. And we will specifically discuss how this is relevant for IBE, for the global epilepsy community, but also for epilepsy chapters at a national and local level and epilepsy advocates to translate words into action and to really leverage this policy framework to improve the lives of people with epilepsy worldwide and achieve a transformational social change for people with epilepsy and people with other neurological disorders. Now let's jump in and talk a little bit about the learning objectives of these of this module. So the first point, of course, is we need to understand what is IGAP all about? What are the main components of IGAP? What are its objectives and the wider significance for the global epilepsy community? The second point I would like to touch on is to understand how IGAP can be leveraged for effective policy advocacy action on epilepsy. In other words, what can we do about IGAP? And a third point is to learn what IBE, what are we doing? What is the International Bureau for Epilepsy doing about IGAP implementation and how you can get involved in some of our activities? So let's jump right in. But before we discuss IGAP specifically, I think it's a good idea to look a little bit into recent epilepsy milestones. And here you have a timeline. On the top side, it shows you the major policy frameworks and reports that have been developed in close collaboration with the World Health Organization, as well as the International League Against Epilepsy, the organization of professional medical practitioners and researchers, healthcare professionals in the epilepsy space, as well as the International Bureau for Epilepsy, serving as the global voice for people with epilepsy worldwide. And one of the milestone reports was the Global Epilepsy Report, as you can appreciate here on the left-hand side, which was co-developed with ILAE and WHO as a landmark report to map epilepsy and specifically map the treatment and inclusion gap, as well as research gaps around epilepsy at a global level, and really hone in on the point that the treatment of epilepsy and improving the social condition of epilepsy of over 50 million people living with epilepsy worldwide is a public health imperative. So this was a milestone report, and it was followed by numerous years of relentless policy advocacy efforts from the global community to, at the end of the day, produce the Intersectoral Global Action Plan on Epilepsy and Other Neurological Disorders. Now, this document is so important. It was ratified and universally, unanimously adopted by the 194 member states of the World Health Assembly, the governing body of the World Health Organization. So, in other words, nearly all countries in the world have signed off on this initiative. And it is really, as the name suggests, a document written for people with epilepsy and those with other neurological disorders worldwide. So it's an important policy framework, and we're going to delve into it. Now, just recently, in December of last year, WHO also launched a epilepsy technical brief directed at improving the lives of people with epilepsy. This is a technical complement that explores the levers for change. And in the subsequent module of the series, my colleague Mary Secco will go into more detail on this epilepsy technical brief. Now, these are important policy frameworks to remember, and it shows that there really has been a lot of momentum over the past couple of years in the global epilepsy community and beyond. At the bottom, of course, you see that IBE has been very active and busy in providing our 150 chapters in over 100 countries with the tools and materials they need for effective advocacy action on the ground. And on the left-hand side here, you see, for instance, in legislative mapping exercise that was carried out by the IBE African region. And this was followed by our advocates toolkit, which will be discussed in further detail in the next module by Mary Secco, as well as a most recent toolkit on stigma reduction, because we know that stigma is, of course, one of the main barriers in this field, and it has specifically been highlighted as an important target of the intersectoral global action plan. So addressing stigma will be absolutely critical to the success of IGAP, and we will talk about that in a minute. But for this module, we chiefly want to focus on understanding what is IGAP, what are the constituents, how is it relevant, and how does it tie into the work that we do at IBE. Here I've highlighted for you our 5-year strategic plan that was launched in tandem with the IGAP. So what is IGAP? It makes sense to take a look at the overarching 10-year goal of IGAP, and I'm just going to read it out. It's to reduce the stigma, impact, and burden of neurological disorders, including their associated mortality, morbidity, disability, and to improve the quality of life of people with neurological disorders, their carers, and families. So there is a lot to unpack here, but you see that it is not just about reducing the burden of disease from a medical perspective, but it is also looking at the social condition of epilepsy and other neurological conditions, and it is chiefly aimed at reducing stigma. So this is a very important component, and we often refer to this as the inclusion gap, closing the inclusion gap, not just the treatment gap, which would be the medical element, but also the inclusion gap for people with epilepsy and other neurological conditions. Why are we doing all of this? Well, we have highlighted here, the end goal is, of course, to improve the lives of over 50 million people living with epilepsy, as well as over a billion people living with neurological conditions worldwide. Now, IGAP consists of 5 strategic objectives and 10 global targets, and we're gonna, of course, go into these in more detail. But just to hone in on why this is so important for the community, it is, of course, as I've said, the first ever global action plan on epilepsy and neurological conditions. It is specifically important because epilepsy is highlighted in this plan. There is an epilepsy specific target, which is a major milestone for the global epilepsy community. And as I've discussed, nearly all countries in the world and all member states of the World Health Assembly have signed off on this plan and committed to this 10-year roadmap. It is also very unique because it brings a multi-sectoral approach. It brings a person-centered approach. It is evidence-informed, which is very important in policymaking because you need to have your numbers. You need to have the evidence when you go to policymakers to back up your claims and to raise awareness on facts that are happening around epilepsy and other neurological conditions. And of course, it takes a human rights approach. There is a specific goal to reduce discrimination and discriminatory legislation against people with epilepsy. And it takes a life course approach. And of course, as I've said, it includes an epilepsy specific objective to strengthen the public health approach to epilepsy. Now, how is IGAP relevant to you as a local chapter, as an epilepsy advocate, as a person with epilepsy, or as otherwise a member of the global epilepsy community? Well, it speaks, as we have seen, directly to the mission, needs, and aspirations of the global epilepsy community, right? And in the first place, we should see IGAP as a powerful tool to support, guide, and promote our work moving forward. And we'll go a little bit into detail as to how we can do it. But it is important to keep in mind that just, you know, because we have IGAP now, IGAP adoption does not equal implementation. So now we must actually put words into action, and we'll explore this moving forward. I really like this summary slide by the WHO Brain Health Unit. It gives you kind of IGAP at a glance, and it shows you the vision, the goals, the guiding principles, and the strategic objectives of IGAP. And if we just focus on a couple of these, it's a vision of a world in which people affected by neurological disorders and their caregivers attain the highest possible level of health with equal rights, opportunities, respect, and autonomy. So this is also speaking to the social elements of epilepsy and other neurological conditions. It is, of course, as we've said, one of the main goals to reduce stigma. And stigma comes in many forms and shapes. It is multi-level. It affects not just the person with a condition, but also the surrounding. It occurs at an institutional level. So there are multiple levels of stigma, and these have to be addressed via a multi-pronged approach. Not surprisingly, the guiding principles also beyond strengthening primary healthcare and fostering universal health coverage relate to empowerment and involvement of persons with neurological disorders and their carers, as well as focusing on gender equity and human rights. So it's very important to keep in mind that it's not just about health, but it's also about all other social domains. And as I've said, there is for the global epilepsy community a specific goal on strengthening the public health approach to epilepsy. That's the strategic objective number 5 for IGAP. Now, ILAE and IBE have put forward the epilepsy cascade target, which was really the approach of the epilepsy community to have a set of concrete metrics that we would like to achieve over the past over the next 10 years of IGAP implementation. And we have recently expanded this target from the 90-80-70 to the 100-90-80-70 target. And this target stipulates that over the next 10 years of IGAP implementation, we want 100% of people with epilepsy to experience an improvement in their quality of life. And this is guided by our desire to achieve that 90% of all people with epilepsy are aware of their diagnosis as a treatable brain condition, that 80% of people with epilepsy have access to appropriate, affordable, safe anti-seizure medicines, and that 70% of people who are taking anti-seizure medicines will achieve adequate seizure control. Now, going a little bit into IBE's strategic plan, you can download this on the IBE website and delve into it in detail. But broadly, of course, we are guided by a mission to achieve a transformational social change for people with epilepsy worldwide. And this is further guided by a set of impact goals that you can see here, one of which is to position epilepsy as a global public health priority, as well as our strategic action areas. And these include advocacy and awareness raising, knowledge creation and exchange, going back to taking an evidence-based approach to policy advocacy, capacity building for our chapters and regions, and very importantly, partnership development. We cannot do this alone, and we need to unite as the global neurology community and global brain health community to elicit a durable and sustainable and impactful change for those affected by epilepsy and neurological conditions. Concretely, looking into IBE's 2023 flagship projects, we have a number of projects that are chiefly intended to implement IGAP, but also to equip our chapters and regions and epilepsy advocates with the tools and resources they need to elicit that change and to walk the talk. And you can see on the left-hand side, one of this is the Global Advocacy Action Project. So this is a series of toolkits, trainings, legislative mapping exercises, and promising strategies programs, which are programs specifically funding IGAP demonstration projects and projects that are directed at achieving IGAP targets. So it's very critical for us to provide our chapters with resources that they can use to then successfully implement interventions, approach government, do awareness campaigns, and other matters related to IGAP implementation. The second main flagship project is IBE Involve, which is a new project because we at IBE, aspiring to serve as the global voice for people with epilepsy, want to include actively people with epilepsy in all of our activities, in all of our research activities, in our policy activities, in our advocacy, in our trainings. And so we are creating a community council of representatives of the community, as well as strengthen our existing youth program and want to create an IBE exchange program where we can really connect our 150 chapters in over 100 countries across all 7 IBE regions, because only synergistically we will be able to leverage the power of this global organization, and we will be able to exchange learnings and best practices as moving forward as one global unit. The third pillar is the Global Epilepsy Needs Survey, because in order to be able to serve the people with epilepsy, we must first do our homework well and conduct a needs assessment and really understand what are the needs. And this is not so easy, because this goes far beyond medical needs. It goes also into all social domains, as we have heard before. And finally, of course, IGAP and the epilepsy community is very mindful that there are groups that are disproportionately affected and that may have unique needs. And this include women, children, the elderly, people living in rural and remote areas. And one of the flagship projects is the Women and Epilepsy Project, where we will have a scientific meeting and meetings directed at knowledge translation, for instance, for topics such as epilepsy and reproductive health, epilepsy and pregnancy. And centrally, you can see this knowledge hub. This will be a digital platform that you can imagine serves several purposes. One is to connect our chapters digitally with one another and to be able to form special interest groups directed at IGAP implementation. It also serves to connect our chapters to the wider community, and it serves to showcase all of the initiatives that are going on, as well as highlighting some of the needs, because there is a lot of good projects, but sometimes there are specific needs, project needs that arise. And it is supposed to be a digital ecosystem connecting different partners to successfully work on projects together. And thirdly, it is serving as a digital marketplace where chapters are able to exchange resources and readily help one another on implementation projects. So going a little bit into IGAP in practice, it's not just about IBE providing resources, but it's also important, of course, for chapters to understand the importance of IGAP and leverage IGAP. And we at IBE have recently developed a compact version of IGAP. It's a two-page document that we call IGAP Unpacked. And it really lists the strategic objectives, their relevance to the global epilepsy community, and proposed actions for IBE chapters and regions. And I just want to go here over two examples. You can download this resource on our website. But just to look at two strategic objectives here, we have the strategic objective to raise policy prioritization and strengthen governance. There are two specific sub-goals here, namely that countries will have national plans, policies, and strategies for neuro conditions, including epilepsy, and that also countries will have functioning awareness and advocacy programs. And of course, this is hugely relevant to our community. There are some facts here about epilepsy that we have mentioned before. Of course, there's a big need, right? If you're thinking about the burden, but also about the treatment gap, right? In low and middle income settings, only one in four people receives anti-seizure medicines and adequate treatment, right? So this is completely unacceptable. And there's a lot more we need to do and must do as a community. And there's also low public awareness of epilepsy as a treatable brain condition. So of course, this program and prioritizing epilepsy from a governance perspective is hugely relevant. And there's a series of proposed actions, one of which is to use the IBE Advocates Toolkit, which we have developed and which Marie Secco will talk about in the fifth and final module of this series. And this can be used for policy advocacy actions, including the writing of position papers, letters, strategies to approach government, and really hold policymakers accountable to what they have signed off on with respect to IGAP. Now, we must also join forces, and I've said this before, this does not just go for IBE and other stakeholders, but also for chapters nationally and locally for epilepsy awareness campaigns. We know that, of course, in many countries, there are several chapters, both IBE as well as ILAE, and it is important to actually join forces across chapters, across organizations, to have one common voice, because united we are stronger in engaging key stakeholders. So it is important to define IGAP priorities at national level. We call this domestication of IGAP, because IGAP is a big and abstract policy framework, and it needs to be adapted for countries. Countries have different needs. So the first step is to actually identify what of IGAP is relevant to our country and who are the key stakeholders that we must engage to successfully approach government. So it is also about building partnerships within neurology, non-communicable disease, and intersectorally beyond health. And that's an important point, because as much as we would love for every country to have an epilepsy-specific program, we must also be realistic in the sense that a government's budget is limited, and sometimes they will have other broader buckets, such as non-communicable diseases or neurology, and even broader buckets under which epilepsy can be placed. So it is important for us to leverage these buckets beyond a mere epilepsy-specific target to think about how can we position epilepsy within some of the wider policy initiatives. Now, the second goal I've picked here is the epilepsy-specific goal of IGAP. It's to strengthen the public health approach to epilepsy. Again, there are two targets. One is a 50% increase in epilepsy service coverage, and one is that 80% of countries have replaced discriminatory legislation. So one target here deals with the treatment gap, and one deals with the inclusion gap. And of course, from an IBE perspective, it is very important to close the inclusion gap, because quite often, as we know, is that stigma and discrimination are some of the key barriers for seeking treatment and getting a diagnosis, right? So these targets go hand in hand. And of course, epilepsy-related stigma, as we spoke about, exists at all societal levels, impairing quality of life and social well-being. As we know, there are many myths, false beliefs, and misinformation around epilepsy. And of course, this can result in serious consequences and can be a barrier to healthcare seeking. And we must remove discriminatory legislation if we are to safeguard the human rights of people with epilepsy, and if we are to break this vicious cycle of discriminatory legislation and stigma. Now, what can we do at a chapter level and as epilepsy advocates? Well, first of all, to remind ourselves that WHO and all member states have committed to this epilepsy-specific objectives. The global epilepsy community has advocated relentlessly over the past decade to ensure that epilepsy is anchored fully as a goal in IGAP. And so we must leverage this to the maximum and hold governments and policymakers accountable. We can do this by raising awareness on and advocating against discriminatory legislation. This IBE has already conducted legislative mapping, and we will expand these efforts to other IBE regions. And we have launched the IBE Stigma Reduction Toolkit for interventions, for instance, in schools and the workplace, right? We know that there's a lot of need which relates to education and which relates to the workplace. And so these are good places to start and think about a stigma reduction intervention. And again, Mary Secco will talk to this in further detail in the next module. And finally, we can build a lived experience repository. Stories are incredibly powerful, and people listen to stories. And so it is very important for people with epilepsy, when people with lived experience, to share their story, and for us to create a repository that can be used for successful campaigning and for successful awareness raising. Now, it is, of course, not just about IGAP, but as I've said, there are various policy frameworks, and we must ensure that we position epilepsy in all of these frameworks. So here you see an overview of the IBE strategic plan with the four action areas that I talked to in the beginning. And on the left-hand side, you have the IGAP targets that are directly impacted as a consequence of our action areas. But we also, as I said, have this ILAE IBE cascade target. This is important for us to measure our progress in the community in addition to IGAP goals. But if we think a little bit further beyond epilepsy, we of course know that we have the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, or SDGs, to be reached by 2030. As Mary Secco has spoken to in the previous module. So to summarize, IGAP provides a global mandate to close inclusion, treatment, prevention, and research gaps in epilepsy. It is a powerful tool to support your policy advocacy agenda and key to hold policymakers accountable. It serves, of course, as an overarching framework, and we must adapt it and make it our own by leveraging those elements that matter most to the country, chapter, and community in which it is to be implemented. And we must remind ourselves that IGAP is only the beginning, so we need to consider complementary policy frameworks such as the WHO non-communicable disease agenda, the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, to make epilepsy central to the global policy dialogue. And finally, IGAP adoption does not equal implementation. We must now put words into action to achieve our goals. So for us, we are, of course, very keen to spark excitement and get you involved into many of these initiatives. And I think a great starting point, of course, is to conduct this e-learning module exercise, as well as take a look at IGAP Unpacked, the one pager which contains further detailed information that may be of use to you as a person with epilepsy, as an epilepsy advocate, as an epilepsy chapter, or as a stakeholder in the global epilepsy community and beyond. And I would also invite you to take a look at IBE's strategic plan for the next 5 years that details many of our initiatives in more detail. You can also contact us at engagement@ibe-epilepsy.org or policy@ibe-epilepsy.org. We really look forward to hearing from you, and please get in touch, please get involved. Together we can make a real difference. Thank you.